Home Depot is one of the most respected companies with more than 2,200 locations in North America. Home Depot is the largest home improvement and DIY retailer in the world. In today's episode, we'll discuss the co-founders of Home Depot who at one point did have $300 to pay for tuition, Ken Langone. Langone was born in a family with a lot of love, but not a lot of money. He had extremely humble origins.
Extremely humble origins. Dad was a plumber, eighth grade education. Mom worked in the school cafeteria, seventh grade education. Humble, but loving and just totally dedicated to their family.
Growing up in Long Island, New York, Langone's parents lived from paycheck to paycheck in a house that was warm in the winter but hot in the summer, but they didn't have air conditioning. His mom worked at his high school. One day, the school principal walked up to his mom and told her that Langone would be lucky if he graduated high school. His mom was devastated.
The best gift I got from them was this unconditional love that was always mine from them and my brother, too.
Were you the first in your family to finish high school and
No. Probably a lot of cousins, a lot of family. I might have been the eighth or ninth to finish high school, and maybe one of the two or three that went to college.
But the first in your immediate family?
First in my immediate family. And my brother graduated from high school 5 years before me. And I have one or two cousins that were older than me. They graduated from high school, but none of them went to college.
Having limited financial resources, Langone had no option but to work multiple jobs in his youth. He started working when he was 11. One of the first things he did was sell scrap cardboard. By the time he was 14, he delivered newspapers, worked at the butcher shop, and cut lawns. As a kid, he would save some of what he earned and spend it on movies and clothes. Langone's mother had a huge influence on him. She wanted the best for him. Once a week, they would visit their grandparents. His mother would take the route through which they would pass the wealthier neighborhood, asking him, "Would you like to live here someday, Kenneth?" His reply, "Yes, Mom, I would." And when she said, "Well, if you want to live here someday, you've got to work hard. You've got to get an education."
Parents, they just felt it was important that I have an education and that I give everything, all my effort, be 100%. Because that's how they were. They had very humble origins. They had no educational background. But whatever they did with passion and belief. My dad, his whole goal in life was to be the best plumber he could be. Mom, same thing. Mom went in the kitchen. "You damn right better be ready for a competitive environment because she's going to make the best pasta and the best brush oil and whatever else we had." So there was a commitment to do the best you can.
And it was his mother's saying that made him go to college. The final semester of college, Langone decided to take two semesters in one. There was only one issue. He wanted $300 to make it happen. Without the money, Langone would have dropped out. Langone discussed his problem with the dean at the college, and the dean was kind enough to help him out with his financial troubles. Langone graduated from college, got his MBA, and went on to work at Wall Street. In the early 1960s, Langone began his career as a Wall Street financial service company. By 1974, Langone formed a venture capital firm, Envemid.
I had this rocket, meteoric rise, and then about 1970, I had this mediocre dive.
And it was this downfall that got ideas rolling in Langone's mind. Langone was having breakfast with one of his friends, Bernie Marcus. Bernie saw an opportunity, who at the time had just lost his job at Handy Dan as a CEO. Handy Dan was a home improvement retailer chain. The only problem was that Handy Dan did not have everything. People would have to visit another store to get their home supplies. Bernie, being the CEO, saw the problem, and after being fired, he discussed it with Langone. They both decided to open a store where they would have everything under one roof so their customers would have the do-it-yourself model, where a customer would be free to shop around themselves. And so the concept of Home Depot came together. The high-ceilinged warehouses that were 75,000 square feet would make sure that they had everything when it comes to home improvement. The first home improvement store opened on May 1979 in Atlanta. As exciting as the opening was, the founders were struggling to get inventory because money was running out. The 60,000 square foot location was almost empty. To give the illusion of having high volumes, they asked their suppliers to send them empty boxes. The store was now filled with shelves of empty boxes to get customers to come inside. Marcus gave away cash. He would stay outside the store with a fist of single dollar bills and give people a dollar if they'd shop at Home Depot. People walked in thinking that the store was full of their favorite products. Word got out, and soon more people started coming in. And the rest is history. Home Depot went public in 1981. Today, an average Home Depot store is more than 100,000 square feet in size, and they have over 35,000 products in every store. As much of philanthropic work Langone has done, he still feels like he's not done anything.
I mean, we have all different forms of philanthropy. The thing that, interestingly enough, to this question, Jim, the first money I gave Bucknell of any consequence, which was then, I thought, a lot of money. Today, in the context of what we've done, you lose it in the rounding. And we always went to mom and dad's for lunch every Sunday with the kids. That's why I love this television show, Blue Bloods. They have the family together every Sunday for lunch, and that brings back my childhood. And so we went to mom's, and Elaine, the kids were all sitting at the table, and mom and dad, Elaine and me. And Elaine says, tell Pop-Pop, that's what we call my dad, the kids call him, tell Pop-Pop what we did for Bucknell. My father loved Bucknell. My father, one of the great joys in his life was to say his son graduated from Bucknell. And I think a lot of my affection for the place emanates from that. So I said, Dad, Elaine and I, we're doing pretty good, and we decided we wanted to do something to help Bucknell, and we did that. I didn't tell him what the amount was. And he said to me, he put his fork down, I'll never forget it, and he said, well, where'd you go with that? I said, what do you mean? He said, well, you gave him that. I said, yeah. And he said, but what'd you give up? I said, I gave up nothing. What are you talking about? And he looked at me and he said, remember this. He said, it's only when you go without something yourself to give to somebody else that it's real charity. But by that standard, Jim, I'm not very philanthropic. I've given nothing up in my life.
Until next time, have a good one.